to tonight. I want to read verses 1 through 10 for you, and then we're going to get on into what the Lord's kind of laid on my heart. But I want to ask you tonight, before I even read this tonight, have you ever really thought about praying and praising going together? When you pray and praise. Prayer and praise. Amen?
Amen.
I want to give you three things to think about as I go into this service tonight. One being, we praise because he is active in our lives as things unfold. That's one thing we do. We pray and praise him because of that. Second, have you ever prayed to the point that you felt like you embarrassed your spirit, I mean your flesh, that you praised him so much in the spirit that your flesh felt a little embarrassed? Don't worry, I got stuff to go with this. You'll see where I'm going with it tonight. And the third one is, have you ever praised him ahead of time before he answered your prayer?
Yes. Thank you.
There's three things tonight that the Lord laid on my heart this week to talk with you about tonight. And I'm going to try to get through them. But one, I want to say it again. Do you praise him because he's active in your life as things are unfolding? Two, have you ever felt like you, in the spirit, embarrassed your flesh? And three, have you praised him ahead of him answering a prayer for you? Amen?
Amen.
Let's get into this word tonight. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. We're talking about Hannah's prayer. And Hannah prayed and said, my heart rejoices in the Lord, and my horn is exalted in the Lord. I smile at my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. No one is holy like the Lord, for there is none besides you, nor is there any rock like our God. Amen.
Amen.
Talk no more so very proudly, let no arrogance come from your mouth, for the Lord is the God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bowels of the mighty men are broken, and those who stumble are girded with strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out of the bread, and the hungry have ceased to hunger. Even the barren have borne 7. And she who has many children have become feeble. And the Lord kills and he makes alive. He brings down to the grave and he brings up. The Lord makes poor and he makes rich. He brings low and he lifts up. He raises the poor from the dust and he lifts the beggar from the ash of heap, to set them among princes, and to make them an inheritance to the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. He will guard the feet of his saints, but the wicked he shall silence in the darkness. For by the strength no man shall prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken in pieces. From heaven he will thunder against them. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth, and he will give strength to his king and exalt the horn of his anointing. Amen.
Amen.
Amen and amen. Tonight I just want to talk with you just a minute about Hannah's prayer. But first I just want to pray with this service, and then we'll get into this word. Dear Father God, I thank you so much, Lord, for this word that you have placed upon my heart to bring to your people tonight, God. God, I pray, Father, they have open ears and open hearts tonight, God, to receive, God, right now, what you have get ready to pour out into this service. God, I ask tonight, God, these ones that come in, that they would understand the necessity tonight, God, to pray and to praise you. God, I ask tonight, God, that you would open up tonight the minds and the hearts in here. And God, that they would just take in what you're getting ready to pour out. God, we ask these things in your mighty Son's name, Jesus' name. And we all say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. I just want to talk with you just a minute tonight. I want to just get you where we're at. We're talking about Elkanah, and he had two wives, Peninnah and Hannah. Peninnah was the first wife that had plenty of children, and Hannah didn't. Her womb had been shut up. She couldn't bear no sons. Amen. Or couldn't bear no children, period.
Amen.
And her prayer was to have a child for her husband. She had wanted a son for so many years, longed and longed for so many years. And the reason I know why God has laid this out, because I want you to ask yourself tonight, have you ever found yourself thinking it's been difficult to pray in faith when you feel that your prayer has been ineffective. And when you feel like you prayed and you prayed and you prayed and you prayed, but you've seen nothing happen in your prayer. How many of you have prayed for the same old thing over and over and over and over again, but it seems like your prayer has been ineffective? Like God just has not heard your prayer. Amen?
Amen.
That's exactly where Hannah was at. But what I want to get on here tonight is this. If you'll just look with me for just a minute. In chapter 1, I just want to just catch you where I'm at. It's just going to be a couple things. In chapter 1, verse 6, or the 5 and 6, he says, "But to Hannah he gave a double portion, because he loved Hannah so much." And they're talking about her husband. "Although the Lord had closed up her womb, but her rival was Peninnah. She provoked her. She mocked her. She slandered her. She made fun of her. She done everything she could to slander her and make her feel bad. Because really and truly she was intimidated by it." Amen?
Amen.
She had the kids. But really, he loved her more than she did Peninnah. He loved Hannah. Mm-hmm. Now Hannah just hadn't been able to bury my son. And here this woman is standing out there praying, trying to get a son. Amen?
Amen.
I don't want to get too far ahead, but I'm going to just go ahead and tell you this woman had prayed for 19 years. 19 years. She had prayed. Some of us today, we feel so ineffective in our prayer that we don't even take criticism right after 30 days of prayer. We'll let the devil criticize us for praying for something after 30 days and we don't see it being answered yet. And then what do? We stop praying. We stop rejoicing. We stop seeking God just because it hasn't happened in the time frame that we set on God to have our prayer answered.
Amen.
So we stop. We stop praying. And tonight I want to tell you tonight, keep praying.
Amen.
I come to you tonight to tell you to keep praying and keep rejoicing in your prayer. How many of you tonight, before I go any further, how many of you tonight have ever caught yourself praying in such a fashion that you started rejoicing in your prayer? You'll see where I'm going with that just shortly. But what we have to understand is even in all that she was doing in her prayer, her husband couldn't help her. All he could see, even Peninnah could see, was the outside circumstances. But God had a plan in motion that none of them could see. God had already had a plan in motion that even Hannah couldn't see. Amen? You tonight have prayed, and I promise you, as you continue to pray, if you'll keep rejoicing in God, He's got the plan in motion for you already.
Amen.
Even though you don't see it, He's still working.
Amen.
Amen. Can somebody say amen tonight?
Amen.
I know it's Wednesday night, but you better praise the Lord, right? You didn't come in here tonight just to see me. You come tonight to praise God, right?
Amen.
We call it Wednesday night fill up. How many come tonight to get your half of the week fill up? Amen. What I'm trying to tell you is keep praying. God's listening.
Yeah.
He hasn't quit listening. He hasn't turned the microphone off. He hasn't turned his ear away from you. He said, if you keep praying and you keep praising, I promise you, I've already got the wheel in motion. I got things set forth that people see the outside, but they don't know what's going on the inside.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
I can think about this as we pray for Sister Margie. All the doctors could see was the circumstances that surrounded her.
Amen.
All they could see was the things that were going on through their tests that they seen.
Yeah.
But they couldn't see the circumstances of the plan that God had already set in motion to heal her of her cancer. Amen.
Yeah.
See, the thing is, we have to understand as we're praying, and she was already rejoicing, God was already sending the healing.
Amen.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen. That ought to make somebody a little excited. My man hurt was bad. What I'm trying to say tonight is if we keep praying and we keep praising, God's going to keep answering the prayer.
Yes,
God's going to keep putting the wheel in motion that when everybody else thinks the door's closing, God's getting ready to knock them down. Amen.
Yes.
See, hey, a man can close the door, but God can knock the door. Hey, don't tell me he can't knock the door down. He made the walls of Jericho fall. Amen.
Yes.
Don't tell me. Somebody what God's plan is.
Amen. Amen.
That's what's so good about God. Man can only see what man sees.
Yes. Yes.
But we can't see what God's got in motion. Hallelujah. I'm so thankful for that tonight, because even when everybody else tries to cancel something out, they can't stop God.
Amen.
That's what's so good about God. Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. So I ask you tonight, are you going to continue to praise Him?
Yes.
I want to say this too in chapter 1, in verse 15, if you'll just follow me there for a minute. We're going to get on into some more here. But it says, just follow me here. She had went to the temple to pray, okay, or to the tabernacle. And the priest had even come up and thought, because she was moving her lips and wasn't very loud, that she was intoxicated, okay? So what I want you to understand is even the minister misinterpreted what she was doing.
Yes.
Huh? How many times have you been misinterpreted on what you're doing? Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Like I just said, people see what they want to see, but they don't know what God's doing. Amen.
Yeah.
She was pouring her heart out. She was saying, you know what? I can imagine that she had come. We're just going to say that Hannah had walked over here in Apollo tonight. And you know what, Brother Gene? She had walked in. And we're going to say that this was the third year of December of 2021. Y'all just ride with me a minute. And she had come in. And she had sat right down here. And I promise you, if she had sat down, probably us as Christians, let's just go ahead and put this out here. Us as Christians, if she had come in here and we had seen her time and time and time again come in this church and come to this altar, we'd have been thinking that she was doing something wrong. Because see, us as Christians, because we come to the altar, oh, I'm going to tell you, we like to thought somebody's on the altar that they've done something wrong. Now see, she hadn't done nothing wrong. She was just crying her eyes out and pouring her heart out to God, saying, God, I know you know my petition. I know you know what my heart is. I know you know what I need. You know what I've been praying for. Will you please answer my prayer?
Yes.
Y'all remember Sunday I said, it really makes me aggravated when we don't see people down on the altar praying with these people that are down here. Because see, I can tell you now, hey, us as Christians, instead of us coming down here and surrounding her with some more power to get that prayer answered, just as then, the minister even misinterpreted what she was down there praying for because he couldn't hear. I don't need to hear your prayer. God's the one that hears it. Amen. I don't need to know what's going on. God already knows. But he needs us to pray with you. He needs us to pray with you. I don't need to know. You don't need to voice it unless God says voice it. But I can tell you now, if you get down and you pour your heart out, I promise you God knows that you're praying and you're praising Him at the same time.
Yes.
Right. Yes. Yes, that's what's sad. And you know what's going on? Right here today, we're still doing the same thing. We misinterpret so many Christians today because we see them down on the altar.
Amen.
If I wasn't your pastor and I had to preach in here every Sunday morning, I guarantee you I'd be on this altar every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, and every Wednesday night. Because like I told y'all the other day, this is the buffet. You can get all you want, or you can get a little bit as you want. But I promise you, if you're going to go through the hell out there, you better get all buffet you can get.
Amen.
Amen. Because I promise you, the devil's getting ready to attack you and attack you and attack you. Let me go ahead and tell y'all something real quick as we're talking about this prayer of praise. You ain't got no choice but to praise Him. Amen.
Amen.
You ain't got no choice but to pray. And this is the thing. I don't mean give a little 5-cent prayer trying to get $1 million answer. I'm talking about giving prayer and praise at the same time. It's because of this. Let me go ahead and tell you something, Christians. Those of you in here that are young and out there trying to be mighty warriors in the Word and going out there in the world doing things for the Lord, I promise you, the closer you draw into God, the more the devil's going to come after you. And if you don't praise Him, if you don't get down and pray, He's going to attack you. He's going to devour you. He's going to come after your finances. He's going to come after your health because He wants your soul.
Yes. Don't tell me
He don't. Because the more elevated God takes you, the more He's going to run after you. Amen. The more elevated you get, the more he's going to try to tackle you. The more elevated you get, the more he's going to try to kick your legs out from up under you. You know why? Because since July, he's attacked my neck. He's attacked my back. He's attacked my stomach. He's attacked my job. He's attacked my house. But he's never going to win because I will do what God told me. And you know why? Because he don't like what's going on.
Amen.
He don't like if 43 people were saved at the cure. He don't like if 50 of them was baptized. He don't like the two of them were saved 2 weeks ago. Amen. He don't like that Miss Tammy's knee got healed back there. He don't like that your knees got healed. He don't like that you quit drinking. He don't like that you still trusting in him. He wants to cause hell right inside this church.
Yes, yes.
But you know what we're going to do?
Amen.
We're going to keep praying and praising right along with you. That's what I'm going to do. Because I'm telling you something. See, there's a lot of churches today that ain't going to make it because they don't know how to pray.
Amen.
And I ain't talking about coming out here and giving no bright light worship team. I'm talking about praising him and worshiping him.
Yes.
I'm talking about getting down to an old-fashioned altar, giving an old-fashioned cry out to the Lord. I'm talking about getting down on your knees and you, hey, when you get up, your back hurts and your knees hurt because you've been out on so long that you know that God heard your petition. Amen?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That you know that God said, you know what? You might be there a little longer, but I promise you in the next 5 minutes I'm going to answer your prayer.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
See, when I told y'all, 3 prayer praises, we're going to get there. See, this is... Man, this isn't going better than I thought. Sometimes we feel barren. Just as she did, she felt barren. She felt empty because she couldn't have a child. You tonight, you feel empty in your work for the Lord. I'm not talking about your job. Some of you tonight, you feel empty in your work for the Lord. And maybe you don't right now, but sooner or later you're going to. The devil's going to try to make you feel empty in everything you do for God.
Okay.
He's going to try to rob you of all your joy. He's going to try to rob you of all your family. He's going to try to rob you of your health. He's going to try to rob you of your mind. He's going to try his best to make you feel empty for all the fill-up that God can. See, like tonight, the more you get filled up, tomorrow morning the devil's going to try to take that fill-up. Amen? Sometime between now and Sunday morning, he's going to come by and try to rob your gas out your tank. Come on, amen?
Amen.
He said, you know what? We do. We feel barren in our work. We feel barren in our service. We feel barren in our relationship because nothing seems to be coming to birth. There's many churches today that's closing right now today because pastors feel very barren because they feel like nothing is coming to birth inside their churches. And you know why? Because they forgot how to pray.
Come on.
They forgot how to pray.
Yes, yes.
Brother Gene, I love you. And I hope you pray. But I don't mean no offense to anybody in here. But I'm going to tell you something. If I want to reach heaven, I want to reach Jesus, I promise you, I ain't waiting on you to get me there. I'm going to get there myself.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to reach heaven first. And you better be doing the same thing. You better not be waiting on old Pastor Dexter to pray your way through. You better be cleaning up your way there yourself so that you know that you know that you know that God knows that you feel a little empty on the inside. You feel a little upturned upside down. You need God to fill your tank back up.
Amen.
Amen.
See, that's where she was at. She felt empty, and we feel empty. You can tell yourself a lie. All you want to say, man, I don't never feel empty. Well, you ain't getting where you need to be getting there.
That's right.
I go ahead and tell you now, if you think you're going to walk around 7 days a week, 365 days a year, 52 weeks a year, and the devil ain't attacking you, you better pull that mirror out you got last Sunday and find out where you at, because I promise you, you ain't on the straight now with God if the devil ain't attacking you.
Amen.
You go ahead and take that lie straight back to hell, because God, hey, he's already got you, and you're too stupid to even know where he's got you. Yes, that's what I say. Paul says, don't be ignorant.
Amen.
Of your circumstances.
Right.
You know why the churches are so tore up today? It's because they don't see the ignorance in their own self to know where their churches are.
Amen.
That's why. It is. We don't even understand just how bad some of our churches are tore up from the inside. wonder why things ain't getting done in the church the way it should be. We wonder why people are talking to us, but yet they don't come to our church.
That's right.
Yeah. It's because we don't even see how empty we really are.
Amen.
We don't really even see how bad a shape we really are in.
Right.
We think just because we're talking a good talk that everything's just fine today. But brother, let me go ahead and tell you something. I can talk you to death, but that don't make that I'm on the right path. That don't mean that I'm doing everything I need to be doing.
Amen.
That don't mean nothing. What my walk is going to be a whole lot better than my talk is.
Yep.
Amen.
Amen.
When's the last time you felt like you've seen things coming to birth than what you've done? But also, how ineffective do you feel in everything that you've been doing lately? I want to tell you this as we go in a little further. We feel ineffective, and God is saying, trust me, I hear your prayer. There's one thing that I really like about this, that God had given me this morning, thinking about Hannah, as Hannah was praying to have this child. And God finally said, you know what, I'm going to bless her to have this child, right? I can imagine as she found out she was praying, she was beginning to understand that something was coming due her way. And it was that child. How many of you feel like right now you're overdue for something to come your way?
Amen. Amen.
Mm. How many of you right now feel like you're a little past due for something to come your way over something you prayed for?
Yes.
That's exactly where Hannah was at. She did. She knew that it was gonna come. And let's get here for a minute. When she found out that she was gonna have this baby boy, Samuel, she had already made a deal with God and said, God, you know, if you give me this boy, I'll give him back to you for all his life. I'll make sure that he's yours. And she did. There's one thing I want to remark on that is this. You better be careful what kind of deal you make with God.
Right.
Be very careful the deal you make with God. Because I promise you, God's going to uphold his end.
Yes, he will.
You better be man and woman to hold up your end.
Amen.
Because if you make deals with God, I promise you, you're going to keep them one way or other. See, there was something out that really stood to me with this, Brother Jeff. Is there was many a times, before that business of mine closed down, that I played with God. God, if you get me through this, I'll get my life right. God, if you help me over this mountain, I'll get my life right. God, if you get my finances straight, I'll get my life right. But see, there was one thing Hannah meant, though. She meant that if God gave her that son, she was going to give that son back to God.
Right.
See, she knew the bargain that she was making. See, me and my ignorance, I didn't realize.
Been there.
Some of us today don't realize what kind of bargain we keep making with God when we don't uphold our end. When we ask God to do something, God's going to do his part. You just better make sure you do yours. Amen?
Amen.
Make sure you do yours. Make sure that when you go to pray with God and you telling God and you asking God to answer a prayer or to do something for you, you make sure. This is what I want you to ask you tonight before I go any further. I want you to just sit here and think a minute how many times that you have asked God to answer a prayer for you, but also how many times have you told God if he answered that prayer, what you do? And ask yourself why he may not be answering it.
Amen.
Did you hold up to your end? Did you do what you told God you'd do? Some of us are going to scratch our head tonight when we leave here and say, you know, I probably did tell God if he'd answer that prayer, I'd have done something a little faster, or a little sooner, or a little different. I know I did. But see, there's something about this though. See, after he answered that prayer, I can imagine her, Brother Gene. Could you imagine right now? Praying for something for 19 years.
And it finally coming due to you.
Could you imagine right now?
I want you to sit and think about it for a second. Some of the prayers you've been praying for just the last 6 months. How many of you would rejoice tonight if that prayer got answered?
Oh, yes. Amen.
Think about it a minute. Think about some things that you've been on this altar at or at home during your devotion or during your prayer time or whatever however you do your prayer, talking with God. If you came into this church tonight and God had answered that prayer, how would you be rejoicing tonight? Would you be as quiet as you are now? Would you be as still as you are now? Say, man, he's lost his mind. No, just right with
him.
Would you really, if think about just, I'm not trying to tear you off, but I want to make a point here. If in just the last 6 months, we ain't even talking about 19 years. Some of us can't even be saved 19 years at the time. Let me tell y'all something real quick to go along with this. 5 years ago, I know most of y'all heard this story about where I met the lady at Bojangles. That morning when I obeyed the Lord, I went to church. I'm going to make this quick. I went to church, and I didn't know this, but there was a lady at Terrell's that morning that had been praying for her husband for 25 years to get saved. 25 years. 25 years. I don't know how long she's been saved, but she's been praying for him to get saved for 25 years. And we were in the choir that day at Terrell's like this year, and we were all singing, and the Lord had really just started dealing with me about that thing. It was first thing in the morning before Sunday school class, the whole 9 yards. And the Lord said, "That's right, I need you to give the testimony about what you've just done before you came to church." So I did. I obeyed the Lord and took everything I could do. I wasn't talking that much in church yet. And the Lord said, "Look, I want you to tell exactly what went on." I didn't tell a dollar amount. I didn't think it needed to be told. That didn't matter. It was just the obedience that's what mattered. Come on, somebody. Amen. It doesn't matter sometimes how much you're doing. It's just being obedient to do what you was told to do. Amen. But see, I've done what the Lord had told me to do. And I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell y'all that it's right here. I was never a part of an old-fashioned Holy Ghost field service. Amen. But I can tell you on that morning, on that day, after I obeyed the Lord from doing what I do at a little old Bojangles, that the Lord showed up in a way at that church, that the Holy Ghost fell in there, and that man that woman had been praying for 25 years stood up off that altar, that pew, and turned out that altar, and he gave his life. And I told y'all all that to say this. And we think we can't lift God up in all things.
Thank you, Jesus.
She exalted him. She lifted him up as the first couple verses say. She lifted his name on high because, I'm going to tell y'all something. She might have been praying for 19 years, but I can guarantee you that Hannah knew in her heart of hearts that God was going to answer that prayer. Amen. I can tell you tonight that if you will keep lifting God's name up and you'll keep praising your Lord and you keep praying to your God, your prayer is going to get answered. Amen. Don't quit praying because he's listening. He's listening.
Yes.
He's listening right now.
Yes.
He's listening right now. As Hannah praised God for answering her son, she rejoiced and lifted the name on high. Hannah praised God for being the rock. How many of you tonight praise him for being the rock in your life?
Yeah.
Amen. Hey, I love my wife. I'm sure some of y'all love your wives and your husband, but I can guarantee you they will not be the rock for you like your Lord and your Savior will be. Amen. And she stood firm on that because she knew God was the one that was going to be the rock and the stability that was standing firm for her. She knew that. He was unchanging. Don't you think this morning he's unchanging?
Yes,
he is.
I need to lie, I'm sorry. He's unchanging. He's a friend that's never going to change. You know there's something about God? You can tell God your deepest, darkest secrets, and he's not going to go tell nobody else.
Amen. Amen.
You can tell God just how bad you feel, just how much you hate the person that you've been to church with, just how much that it agonizes you, just how much that you wish you could get those thoughts out your mind, but God's saying, you know what? I don't have to tell them. I'm going to take it out. Your wife will go tell the woman that you shouldn't have been talking about. Your friend will go back and stab you in your back.
Yeah.
And everybody else will know what's going on. But God's saying, don't worry about telling them. Come to the source. Amen.
Yeah.
Come and pray to me. Because I'll be the one to take it away. Everybody else will know the details. And they don't need to know the details.
Yeah.
They just need to know that God showed up anyway.
That's right.
Right?
That's right. Bless him, Lord.
He's the rock.
Yes, he is.
He's the rock. He's the one that we can go to and say, God, you know what? I don't know why I feel the way I feel. I don't know why I think the way I think. I don't know why things are the way they are. But I know that you're going to take care of it. Amen. I know that you hear my prayer. And I'm going to pray a little more. I'm going to praise on top of it. Because I know that you're going to see me through.
Amen.
I know you're going to see me through. I know you're going to take care of every bit of it.
Yes.
I know you are. You're my rock.
Yes.
That's the one thing I got in my life. You know what? This is what we got to understand. Now, when everything else falls,
Amen.
He's the rock.
Yes.
When everything else goes away, he's the rock.
Yes.
When the pastor won't be your friend, he's always going to
yes.
be there. When your brother in Christ upsets you and does you wrong and slanders your name and spits on you and slanders you, you're the rock. He's still going to be your rock.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
He's still going to be the one even when you do wrong. Even when you say something you shouldn't say and you put your foot in your mouth and you twist things you shouldn't have twisted, guess what? He's still going to be your rock.
Yeah.
Somebody ought to give him some praise.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's still going to be your rock. That's why she lifted his name up.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's why she exalted him to say, God, I know I've been praying a long time. I'm getting old. I feel barren in my body. I feel empty in my prayer. I feel ineffective in my body. I feel ineffective in my prayer. Can you imagine how his other wife made her feel?
Yeah.
Think about this a second. Could you imagine? I know some of y'all ladies, I'm going to tell you, some of y'all ladies is mad now. Could y'all imagine having another woman in the house with y'all trying to get y'all's man's attention? Some of you trying to get too much now. Can you imagine what you're trying to get if you had another woman in the house? I mean, y'all laughing, but I'm being serious.
Yeah, that's the truth.
And she was having all the kids and she couldn't have none. You know how ineffective she felt? Could you imagine how bad she felt within herself, within her mind? Can you imagine how the devil was saying, you know what? Man, you sorry. You ain't no good. You might as well go on out there and throw yourself to the wolves out there. That man don't love you. That man don't want you. You can't even have a child for him. And look at what that other woman's doing for him.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to tell y'all something. There's a lot of y'all men feel the same way too. We feel like we're not being effective. We don't feel like we can give our wife enough. We don't feel like we're doing enough for our families. We don't feel like we're being effective in our families' lives. Y'all can sit here and be quiet all y'all want, but I know I'm telling you the truth, amen. I'm a man too, and I try to do everything I can for my wife and for my kids and for the people around me and for this church. But there's a lot of days that the old devil gets right up inside this old locked up box of mine, and he says, boy, you ain't doing no good. Boy, you ain't making no headway. Boy, you ain't being effective, and I'm going to tear you apart. And you know what I got to do? I got to get down, and I got to cry out to God, and I got to say, God, I know you know my heart. I know you know what I'm trying to do. And I'm going to keep moving. I'm going to keep moving. Don't tell me you don't feel better than you don't feel. Don't tell me you don't feel guilty. Don't tell me you never feel ineffective.
Trust.
We do feel ineffective. We feel ineffective in everything we do.
Thank you.
I don't care what you do, how much you got, you still feel ineffective.
Yes, yes.
And that's exactly how she felt.
But you know what she done? One thing that a lot of us don't do, she kept praying. She kept praying. You know what we do today, though? See, a lot of us today, and I'm having a good time, thank the Lord. See, a lot of us today, we go, we think we on the high road. I'm getting ready to stir the hornet's nest up. We think we on the high road because we've been serving the Lord for a few years. Everything's been just fine. What you better be careful of, though, is when the mess comes, is if you know how to pray.
Right, brother.
Because these people that we surround ourselves with, let me go ahead and tell you something. When the water gets muddy, I promise you they're going to leave you.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
You better realize where the true water comes from. It comes from God. Amen.
Amen.
He's the river of life, not nobody else. Amen. I promise you, when all hell breaks loose, He's going to be the rock that you stand on.
Yes, yes.
It ain't going to be on nobody else. When that muddy water comes, you better know that you know that you know how to pray.
Amen.
And you better know
yes.
that you're effective when you pray. Amen. Amen. You better know that when you go down and you get serious with the Lord, that His. I'm going to go ahead and tell y'all something. I'm just going to follow the Lord. See, we better learn to understand that when we start praying, I'm going to tell you right now, honestly, I don't mean this in no bad way, but I hope I pray that somewhere down the line, y'all know how big elephant ears are. Have y'all ever really seen how big elephant ears are? They big, ain't they? Really? You ever been to the zoo? Them doctors got some big old ears on them. Well, I'm going to go ahead and tell y'all something. I hope and I pray that when I get there and I pray that I'm just that effective, that they hear it that big. Amen. That my God, I'm not saying His ears is that big, but He can hear that big.
Yes.
Y'all ain't getting that, did you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes.
See, we better understand something.
Thank you, Jesus.
We better be effective. It ain't time to play.
That's right.
Playtime was over with when you got it.
Jesus.
Bless you, Lord.
See, we don't understand. We in a life and death situation in this church tonight. Yeah.
That's right.
You know that? You one breath away from life and one breath away from death.
That's right.
You one breath away from praising God. And one breath away from praying to God.
Amen.
Right now tonight, you that close. You that close tonight to giving Him praise or going to meeting. I don't know about y'all, but I want to praise Him while I'm going to your meeting.
Amen.
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 Amen. I want to learn how to be that effective.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? See, some of us think that we just affected because we can say a little nice prayer.
Amen.
And we make some good sounding words. Amen? We think just because we give flashy words that, you know, we're effective. Maybe I say that because I'm just old dumb little old redneck or whatever you want to call me. But I don't need flashy words to make my prayer effective.
Right.
Amen? What makes my prayer effective is what pours out my heart. See, the thing is, when I get real with God, hey, the Holy Ghost starts interceding for me. I don't have to speak no more because the Lord starts pouring into me to come out what needs to come out. I don't have to give flashiness, but I got to give my heart.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
That's what we've gotten away from. We've gotten to the point that we feel like we got to be flashy in what we do. No, we got to be effective in what we do.
Amen.
Flashiness ain't going to get us nothing, but effectiveness will change the world outside.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
We got to be effective. And she was effective. Now, I want to go ahead and try to wrap this up. She was effective. Even though Peninnah provoked Hannah severely, she was arrogant about her children. There was one thing that she was and a lot of us are. What do you think there was one thing that you would do right now if somebody provoked you enough? Would your old arrogance come up out of you, or would you let God take action and take justice? See, we have to understand, in order to see the maturity in us, we have to understand that when we get provoked, that we don't take action. Because I can promise you in your flesh, you're going to be ready. Brother Jimmy's already shaking his head. Brother Jimmy, but you know what I'm saying? See, in our flesh, we're used to handling things with these right here.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? When you violent, you use two violence. When things come at your way, you know what you want to do? You want to cuss them out. And next thing you want to do is you want to
truth is that's how we act.
Amen.
You know, how many of you, don't sit here and lie, don't hold your hand up, but how many of you right now have had to restrain yourself from getting outside of yourself? I'm gonna go a bit further. What are you in here tonight? Ain't had to do that. You better listen. I got some more beers left in that box right there.
Amen.
You might want to get a couple of them. You say, I'm just telling you the truth. I say what I say because there's some beers right there you need to look at, because if the devil ain't trying you like that, then you really ain't on the righteous path that your mouth says you are.
Amen.
Because I promise you, the devil's going to provoke you, and he knows how to provoke you.
Yes.
He even knows who to come and provoke you with.
Yes.
Jesus, Peninnah provoked her about her children and slandered her and did everything she could do to ridicule her.
Yes.
But you know what I liked about it? She stood tall.
Yes.
She took the high road out. See, Brother Gene, one time I went up by the high road. I'd rather take it to the dirt road.
That's right.
But see, what we have to do after we get saved is we have to take the high road and let God take action.
Amen.
Let God take action. And he did. See, he knew the evilness in Peninnah's heart, but he knew the goodness in hers. Does God really know tonight the goodness in your heart? Because see, this is the thing. We can fake a lot of things. Fake worship, fake prayers, fake singing.
Amen.
Fake preaching. But you'll never fake your heart.
That's right. That's right.
You will never fake your heart to God.
Amen.
You will never fake it. Just as you sit in this church service and just as you go home tonight, and you talk about people outside this church and you talk about people in the street, God knows your heart.
Yes.
We don't have to hear it. Don't make no difference if we do. Because you don't have to answer nobody in here.
Amen.
But God already knows your heart.
Yes.
God already knows your heart.
Yes.
See, that's what we have to understand. Because we can come in church and we can make things look so good.
Yes.
I sent a little picture on Facebook today about a little chihuahua that was barking, saying that this was mama in the morning before everybody got to church, and then it was real pretty with a little bow in her head in church, and that was mama. That's a lot of us Christians today too.
Yes, it is.
Teeth showing, blood coming out, ready to sell out. And then when we get to church, praise the Lord. Amen. I love Jesus.
Yes.
You better love him more than just inside this church. You better love him inside your heart. I got a video I'm going to show y'all probably right here coming up. Not tonight. And it shows a church. And I'm getting ready to close. I got three places we're going to close real quick. But it shows a church on a Sunday morning. On a Sunday morning that the rapture is just taking place. Half the church is gone, and the other half is just crying out to God. Ain't nothing left but the clothes sitting on the pew. So I ain't got to worry about that. I hope you don't. I hope you were the ones that God knocked the door down for you. Because if you ain't, you're going to be one of the ones that you're sitting here wondering where, knowing where everybody else went.
That's right.
Because see, this is the thing. What people have to understand is once you make it into heaven, you ain't never going to remember that one that was faking no one.
Amen.
Right.
But they're going to remember every time they fake when they come in God's house.
Amen.
See, they're going to remember every time that they had an altar call that they didn't come to. They're going to remember every time that God said pray and they didn't pray. They're going to remember every time that the Holy Ghost showed up and said, rejoice in me. And they didn't rejoice.
Yes, yes.
But for the ones of us that are right, I said, the ones of us, I can tell you now, I'm going home, amen. And I ain't talking about 1820 caps. I'm talking about heaven, amen.
Amen.
I told y'all Sunday, I've been losing sight of my whole life. I'm on the winning team, and I'm staying there. Amen. I'm going to be the first day of faith, and I'm going to play the team. Amen. I might not let me hit the home run, but I'm going to be part of the team.
Yes.
See, that's the problem. We got too many people out there trying to knock the home run to make ourselves look good. You just better be careful that you ain't lost part of the team.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
Make your prayer effective.
Yes.
I want to hit these three things real quick so I can close tonight, because I don't want to hold you past time on a Wednesday night. Y'all okay? Y'all got just a minute?
It's all good.
Y'all right here?
Yes, sir.
I just want to hit these three things and we're going to close. Verses 4 through 9, you ain't got to read them, just follow along with me. It said, God can break everybody one. God can strengthen the weak. God can feed the hungry. God can make the barren unbarren. God can kill. God can give life. God can put you in the grave. God can bring you up out the grave. Amen?
Amen.
That's the kind of God you serve tonight. He can make you rich. He can also make you poor. He can lift you up. He can make you low. He can make your ashes beautiful. He can let the beggar inherit the throne of glory.
Amen.
How many of you do not want to inherit the throne of glory?
Amen.
If we don't, something's wrong with that. It says, for he holds the pillars of the earth, he guards his people, and he will silence the wicked. By no man's strength shall they ever prevail.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, I asked y'all in the very beginning, and I wrote down there's three levels of prayer and praise. I want to touch these three real quick. First, we were already there. We praise because he is active in our lives as things unfold. Hannah prayed and praised God. Listen to me a minute. She prayed and she praised God because God was active in her life. And as her child was being birthed, she rejoiced in it.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
As things was unfolding that she could see, and she knew that God was active, she praised him because she had prayed. See, there's nothing wrong with praising God after your prayer gets answered. Amen?
Right.
I want to go a little further with you. I want to go two more steps. Your spirit embarrasses your flesh. How many of you have ever felt like you embarrassed your flesh? By how you worship the Lord in your spirit. Some of you don't know what I'm talking about yet because you ain't letting the Holy Ghost be activated in your life yet. I'm just telling you like it is. King David praised God, and he praised God in a way that his wife thought that he was undignified in the way that he danced and he leaped around after God made him leader of the nations. Amen? And see, the thing is, he praised him the whole time, and it didn't matter what he looked like, it didn't matter how undignified he looked like, he still praised God for answering his prayer, for making him king over Israel. He didn't care. He said, you know what, in your evil heart, I know your evil heart don't like what I'm doing. I know you don't like how I preach. I know you don't like how I see. You don't like how I play the harp. You don't like how I dance. And guess what? You can go be mad in your corner. I'm still going to worship the Lord.
Amen.
I really think that David let his spirit, for just a slight moment, embarrass his flesh. You know what's wrong with churches today? We won't let our spirit be active because our flesh is stronger than our spirit is.
Yes.
Right.
And you wonder why the Holy Ghost ain't filled you up yet. It's because you won't let your flesh get out of the way.
Amen.
Amen. Come on.
You ain't never been able to have your flesh embarrassed yet because your spirit ain't active. Right. Yes. You can't embarrass your flesh when your spirit don't know what to do.
That's right.
Boy, that's deep.
Truth.
We think we're too dignified. I'm going to hurry up. I only got one left. We do. We think we're too dignified. I'm dressed too nice. I can't act like that. Miss Margie felt that. I'm dressed too nice. I can't act like that. My wife's here. I can't go worship. I can't run around this church and go to the altar and pray. My wife's gonna think I'm crazy. Well, I'm glad to tell you something. My wife thought I was crazy since the day we met. She probably thought I'm crazy before I die. But I'm still gonna serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Don't let your dignity take your soul.
Amen.
serve the Lord. See, the thing is, see us, see, we don't like to know because we think that we look weak when we serve the Lord in the Spirit. Yeah. We think that we look weak. We think that because, well, just because. How many of y'all heard that? Well, just because. Brother Jeff Feller. See, just because he, Brother Gene acts like that don't mean I got to. Well, I'm going to tell you that if somebody's in your church acting like that, you might better ask yourself why you ain't. Just because they might be praying and praising him a little harder than you are.
Amen.
It ain't a competition though. We ain't in competition.
Amen.
But sometimes people do have to learn to submit themselves though.
Right.
We're going to get into that a little later too. See, we got to where people come into church and they forget to submit to the elders of the church. Because the elders of the church can teach them things that they don't know.
Amen.
And that don't mean my age.
That's right.
That means my wisdom and understanding of God.
Amen.
Amen.
We'll have to get on that later. We don't have time for that tonight. And my last point tonight is this. Y'all don't mind with me. I got 2 minutes. 2 minutes, I'll let you go. Praise him ahead of time. Praise him ahead of time. When's the last time you praised God ahead of time and you hadn't even seen him answer your prayer yet? That's a tough thing. It's tough to say, well, I'm going to praise God. And my back wouldn't touch yet. I'm going to praise God and he hadn't even taken alcohol yet. Oh, I'm feeling the Holy Ghost. I'm going to praise God. Can't even fill me up with the Holy Ghost yet. As Paul and Silas was chained in that prison, this is what I want to really touch y'all with tonight. As Paul and Silas was chained in that prison, they went to praising and singing
yes.
in the Lord.
Yes.
They were effective.
That's right.
Huh? They were effective. Sister Sarah, they were effective to the point. Boy, I'm going to tell you something. There's something about some good old-fashioned prayer, ain't you?
Yes.
Think I'm crazy all you want, it don't make no difference to me. Don't make no difference.
Bless you, Lord.
I know I'm being effective. They were so effective that when they prayed and they sang in the manner that they did, that they shook the foundation of heaven, that God shook the foundation of the earth and had a great earthquake come up. And hey, you know what it did? It broke them free of their chains that they were chained. And opened the gates in the jail cell. I'm going to tell you tonight, you need to break free of why you can't pray and praise God the way he's trying to get you to.
Yeah.
Amen. You need to break free of these things and start praying and praising God every day through all things.
Amen.
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 And pray and praise him ahead of time. You want to see God really move in your life? Give him credit for something you ain't even seen yet.
That's right.
And say, I don't mean no harm, but you did somebody God laid on my heart. But we're going to go ahead and give you praise. He's going to save your husband.
Yes, Lord.
Brother, we're going to go ahead and give him praise that he's going to take drugs away from Alan.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
And watch God move. Watch God show up. Watch God do things that we didn't think. I'm getting ready to speak. I know I'm speaking prophetically to you tonight, but I'm just following God. I'm just telling you tonight that God is tired of people not being effective in prayer. God is trying to say, look, if you'll pray and you praise me at the same time, I'll turn hell over for you.
That's right.
When is the last time you turned a rock over for God? When is the last time you turned your pillow over in your bed because you cried so hard on it?
Jesus.
Because it was wet, you needed to get to a dry spot. Because you were praying and praising Him so much that you couldn't stop the overflow of tears flowing out of you. That's being effective. That's being effective in your prayer. You say, I ain't got to pray like that. Maybe you don't have to. Maybe you don't have to pray like that. But maybe you ought to ask yourself, too, why your prayers haven't been answered.
Yes.
Maybe you need to ask yourself tonight, too, to when's the last time you really prayed and praised Him at the same time to know that you know that your prayer was going to be answered. To know that your children are going to be saved. To know that your children are going to be the next one to be like the state of Michigan is right now with 4 dead and 5 more still sitting in the hospital. See, when we pray effectively, when we lay down in the bed at night and we hold one of those hands and we say, Lord, it's been a good day and I thank you for it. Lord, it's been a great day and I thank you for it. But right now, I need you to protect my children. I need you to protect my house. I need you to protect them in their car when they get in it and they leave out this yard. I need you to know that I've been effective in my prayer, that my children belong to you, God, that my family belongs to you, God, that my prayer has been answered, God.
Thank you, Jesus.
And then when I wake up and I come up out of the bedroom, it just comes right off because I know God's being effective.
Yes,
yes.
Amen. And then I can walk around even when Satan is trying to turn the world upside down.
Yes.
Oh, no. Even when he's attacking you.
Thank you.
Maybe he's not attacking you right now. Maybe he's not.
Yes.
Thank God for it. Thank God for it. I went a long time without him attacking me too. I went a long time without him attacking me too. But the more effective I get for God, the more he chases. And the bigger this church gets, the more he chases. And the more you do for God, the more he's going to chase you, amen. The more you sing for God, the more he's going to come after you, amen. The more you tell people about God, the more he's going to come after you.
Yes, right. Yes,
make
yes.
your prayer effective.
Yes, Jesus.
And praise him at the same time.
Jesus.
And say, God, I know that you know. I can't see what's in motion, but I know that you do. I know that you see what's in motion today. People around me may see me as a fake. People around you may think as you as a fake. People around you may think things about you that ain't true. See, that's one thing about people in church today. We still haven't learned the one thing that we were told to do from 5K up. Sit down and be quiet.
Amen.
Because we love to talk too much.
Amen.
We love to gossip too much. And then we love to try to lie and cover it up. 1 John says, if you tell them the truth, because I am the truth. I am the truth, the way, and the life.
Amen.
If you know the truth, then a lie shall not be in you.
Amen. Amen.
And see, today we run around and we tell so many lies. Yeah, I'm saying it. People sitting up in the church, we tell so many lies to cover up something that somebody said because we're going around telling things that we shouldn't be saying.
Amen. Amen.
And we got to tell a lie to cover it up. Then our prayer is not being heard. And we're not rejoicing because we're chasing after things we shouldn't be chasing to go around.
Amen.
Listen to me tonight, people, as I close this out. Don't you think right now this is a good song for right here, will you?
It is.
Don't you think right now, I want you to stand on your feet for a second. Don't you think right now, I want you to just think of this a second. I know this is way back when, don't you think of this a second. If you were standing in Hannah's shoes, I know that's kind of weird for a guy. But if you were kind of in somewhat a position of standing in Hannah's shoes, and it seemed like you had been praying for many, many years for things to happen and they still ain't happening. How long do you think you would stay there before you went into bed? How long do you think that you would continue to pray before you went into some kind of sorrowful time? Before you went into like a pity party to feel like, well, God just don't love me. And God's just not going to answer my prayers. But how many of you would have done like him? Trusted into the Lord to the point that she knew that God was taking action for her because he had heard her prayer. See, God had taken action to answer her prayer. She didn't even know it. But she never gave up. She never rolled over into a pity party with all of them, all the things that were said about her from Padilla and nothing else. She could have rolled right over into a pity party and she didn't do it. She continued to pray. She continued to fight. That's what she's doing. I ask you tonight, will you continue to fight for your prayers to be answered?
Yes, Jesus.
Will you continue to fight to have your prayers answered, or are you just going to give up? See, she could have given up, Brother Jim. She could have given up and said, you know what? I've gave up. I've been praying for 17 and a half years, and I'm just giving up. I've done all I can do. Any of y'all know some people like that? I've been praying, you know, the thing is I know people that's been in church for just a few years now, and I've been praying and praying and praying. But they don't hardly ever come to church, and they wonder why the prayers aren't answered.
That's right.
Yes, I'm stepping on some toes. That's fine. But God is only going to be faithful to the ones that's being faithful to him.
Amen.
But are you ready tonight to fight for your prayers to be answered? You want your prayer heard? Fight for it. Fight for it. You know how you fight for it? You pray and you praise him. You pray and you praise him. You pray a little more and you praise him a little more. You go a little deeper and he's going to go a little further. Amen?
Amen.
Start turning the rocks over. Start turning the rocks over. Start turning the pillows over. Start turning the pages in your Bible over some more. Start praying some more. Start stepping outside the box some more. And see how God answers your prayer. And another thing too, as I open this altar up, go ahead and give him praise for something right now tonight. I dare you. How about this?
Hallelujah.
I dare you tonight. I dare you tonight to give him praise over something that you've been praying for, that you're going to go ahead and give him glory over, that you know that he's going to answer. So I dare everybody sitting in this church tonight to just say, God, I know you're going to answer that prayer. I know you know what I've been crying over. I know you know what I've been wanting help. I know you know my body needs touched. I know you want your children saved. I know that you want this to go on in your life. I'm going to go ahead and give you praise over it. Because I know that you're going to answer my prayer.
Thank you, Jesus.
I dare you. For those of you that welcome that dare, I welcome you to the altar
Thank you, Jesus.
To receive your prayer to be answered.